Thank you very much. Okay, we've got loads of people. So I guess that everyone's here who's gonna be here. Good. Thanks for the intro, Whitney. So in the last few weeks there's been one notable change. The project has been completely renamed because it turned out that there were two other programming languages called Teal, which I hadn't known when I first chose that name. So that was a bit of a mistake. It's now called Hark. So I'm going to be talking, but the big matter is entirely the same. Let's share screen. Right.
Good. Yeah, we can hear, we can see your infinite screen.
Excellent, love the screen. Okay, so I can't hear you to interrupt something wrong. Yeah, okay. So this project kind of stood as an experiment. It's still very much experiment, and I kind of want to spend 30 minutes to so that is a different way of thinking about software. And I think it's interesting to learn different ways of thinking because it lets us look at problems in different ways. So example, learning a type, which is actually really useful for Python programming because it changes you think about us. So that's the context. The project is called Hark, and it's on GitHub, and it's going to answer this question: how can we go beyond thinking about infrastructure and infrastructure code? How can we build applications actually even knowing what the underlying infrastructure is? Sorry, what was
Rick,
that?
Sorry, I'm so sorry to interrupt you. Your audio is very choppy again.
Oh, no.
Is there anything that you think you could try and do? Or perhaps just reload the page. Actually exit the room and rejoin the room, and then I'll give you presenter rights immediately.
Mm-hmm.
And or export your slides as a PDF, and rather do that instead of screen share.
Yeah, I've got a PDF. I do.
Okay, maybe try and switch that. Maybe try and switch that as a start.
Let's do that. It will be interesting when I start doing a demo. Okay. So, all right. Load. Doing a trick here. Taking a PDF video. All right. Amazing. Okay. How's it how now?
We try talk a little bit more.
Yeah. Yeah.
Seems to be a bit better. So maybe we can try restarting, but we use your PDF version. If you'd leave the room and come back, I'll make you moderator and presenter again really quickly.
Yeah. That's the line from Hammond. Okay. We'll go back.
Okay.
All right, third time lucky.
Okay, 1 second. It didn't seem to, sorry, just finding you in this list. It was jumping on quite a lot earlier. So you should be fine now.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, you're doing good, right.
Doing well, okay, let's have a go. I'll try to speak quite slowly and hopefully that'll help. Okay, we're going to get some comments shortly. So much better. Wow. Okay, so the system is just refresh every 3 minutes. All right. Let's go from here. So the gist of this, the best way to think about what I'm doing right now is saying, okay, if I'm trying to build a cloud system and particularly cloud system serverless systems, which I'll explain in a sec, what would a compiler for the cloud look like? And why is this interesting? Well, so serverless and managed services in the cloud, the general idea is that you can build cloud systems without having to manage your own infrastructure, which is a great proposal. But the problem is that as you hand off management of infrastructure, you end up using many, many different pieces of infrastructure and tying them together and trying to build these complicated applications composed of many pieces, which is great, but it means managing all of those pieces. And to me, that feels quite a lot like the job that a compiler should be doing. So that's my mindset. And when I talk about serverless, I'm really, really referring to cloud functions or functions as a service. And this is the idea that you can take a small piece of Python code or JavaScript code, you can package it up, you can deploy it onto your cloud platform, and it will just run in response to some events in your cloud. So it's a little bit like an embedded device. If you've ever done any electronics, this is where my background sort of is interesting. An embedded device is a very much event-driven system where you've got lots of different things happening. If you had a chance to jump into the talk earlier on concurrency, which was fantastic, I really liked the description of what a concurrent system is, which is many things happening independently at the same time, which is exactly what a cloud system is. The problem is that that kind of implies there's a lot of complexity. And there are lots of different ways of dealing with it. And so one of the things that we do is we create these diagrams, which try and explain where data is flowing in our clouds. And they kind of make us feel good because they're complicated and they're pretty, and you can like make a nice, you can render them nicely. And so there are lots of tools for making these pretty pictures. But it's not where you can't, and you can't really you can't write large applications in them. It just kind of all collapses. So my question with this project is, how can we make serverless feel like software? How can we make this kind of large application feel like software rather than making it feel like building some scaffolding, and 90% of the project is scaffolding, which is sort of what it feels like to me now. And to do that, we're going to look at a very, very simple example. This is something that we were doing in my previous job. We were building these kinds of applications. And it's worth mentioning that it's a very, very simple project spec here, but it kind of applies to lots of different kinds of data pipelines or workflows or sequences of things that you want to do in the cloud. So we want to do some computation. We want to compute some value y, which is the result of of three chain functions. And some of the constraints are we want to use serverless because reasons. And the constraint on the functions is that they take several minutes to run. And that's kind of important because serverless cloud functions typically have execution time limits. So it's a little bit contrived, but this is actually a very much a real case, a real use case that you might want to do with cloud functions. So, okay, how do we do that? Well, naively, we would say, right, we will just call each cloud function or each Lambda function as the output. So we'll just literally chain them one after another. And that kind of makes sense conceptually, and it would work. In simple cases, and you can play around with AWS Lambda, which is the AWS platform's cloud function. You could build this kind of thing. Then you would write some tests for your individual functions, which is great. You might kind of try and build some kind of integration test platform. You might set up a staging environment in your cloud. It's tricky to build integration tests for that entire pipeline. So you might try and set that up locally with a tool like LocalStack, which sort of emulates or simulates the AWS environment. But already you're starting to find that there's some complexity in this development process. And the correct way of doing this at the moment is to use this kind of model where you place queues between your functions so that if one of them fails, you're guaranteed some kind of, there are some guarantees around how data is going to flow through your system. And you've got very tight control over where failures go, for example. If one of those functions fails, you need to know about that and you need to react to it in some way. And this works really, really, really well, to be honest. You can build some pretty robust, stable systems with this, but it's going to take quite a lot of work, and there's going to be quite a lot of overhead in terms of development. So there's going to be a lot of, if you're using infrastructure as code, and I totally recommend using infrastructure as code, there'll be a lot of it, and you can modularize it, but fundamentally you're going to have to build each of those pieces yourself. Fine, it's great if you want that level of control, and it will work quite well. What I want though, from my wave my magic wand as a developer and as a software engineer, in my lazy software engineer mindset, what I really want is I want to use the Python code that already exists for my F, G, and H. I want local testing from start to end, and I want that to be kind of trivial and easy. When things go wrong down the line in the pipeline, I want contextual debugging. So when something goes wrong in the final step of the pipeline, I want to know everything that happened before that, kind of like a normal traceback in any old Python program. I want some kind of operational support. So I want to be able to restart and stop things. I want to see the state of my system. I want to understand the load. All that kind of stuff. It's kind of implicit in developing cloud systems. You want to be able to run them. Finally, I want, this is kind of contentious, but I'd quite like to be able to write my applications and then deliver them to any cloud provider. Kind of like in the same way that we can write Python programs and get them to run on any kind of operating system. I think that should be possible in the cloud as well. So let's try some hack. Let's see if this works. I will start sharing my screen. I imagine, let's see what the low quality is like, see if that helps with the audio. And if it doesn't, we'll have to come up with something else. I might just talk through it. So let's do screen share. So I can't see the chat anymore, so interrupt me if the audio is completely dead. How's it sounding now?
Sounds good.
Oh, fantastic. can you see the code? Can you see anything?
Yep, we can.
Sweet. All right, fantastic. Okay. So from the get-go, I'll say this. Hark is a language, it's a way of thinking. It started off embedded in Python. That was the original approach. And that became kind of which I'll talk about later. For now, it's in a separate file and there are colons, and I apologize. please don't notify me. It made browsing easier. So this is hard on the left, and we can do some very basic things that you would kind of expect. And this is our directory, and we can get the print stuff, and we can get it to return things, kind of what you would expect. let's do something interesting. So I'll go to, we've got some Python. Our goal was to take some Python functions and then pipeline with them. These functions do anything interesting, just do very basic math, and I haven't actually even checked them out. It's fine. Let's define our Python. Compute takes a single parameter x, and it returns f of g h x, and we can just use this to compute x. When park service is okay, it's running in function. Let's replace that with one. Convenient example of what happens when you do something. So you get traced back and it looks pretty, needs more work. Anyway, and I haven't shown you import function from Hark. We've got our Python functions defined here, and to call them from Hark, we want to tell Hark with. So we've got F, it lives in the main file and makes arguments. This is a foreign function, so it basically tells the Hark compiler how to call that Python function. So when I call it here, it knows it's using the Python function, which is in source.main, and one argument, which is this function. And we can, great, okay, so that's running. We've got our Python output and a result, which is being returned. We can deploy it to AWS. I'll deploy it firstly, show you effectively what's happening. The infrastructure that's being deployed now is fixed. It won't change. It changed after this point. And then we can invoke it, which is calling that Lambda function and getting some results. And the first time you call it, it takes, so if you haven't come across serverless before, Lambda has a problem where it takes a while to start the first time. This is not intended for extremely responsive web applications. But at the moment, it's running in SQL, and really we work some kind of async pipeline where each function happens as own Lambda function. So that, and find a couple of helper functions to happen. This syntax, I hope if you saw the talk earlier, nice. What we're saying here is call each of the functions in a separate thread. Async, this thing is basically like go and run h in a separate thread and give me something that I can use to the end of that. And then call h, it with that object, we can then await on, and then pass the value of the pipeline. And similarly, we can go and deploy and invoke again. The output won't be different.
Ric, yes. Just to keep in mind, your audio is a bit choppy, so just talk quite slowly, perhaps.
Oh, it's choppy again. Okay. I will endeavor to slowly. That's very annoying. I do. I'm sorry about that. Okay. Let's see and go. We'll mention another thing that's important about what's happening here. Main is in something called zero, and when thread zero runs, it calls compute, and when compute runs, it starts looking for one of these other threads. At that point, thread zero entirely stops. And while the other threads carry going in the background, and that's really important because when you've got something calling, you're basically wasting compute time, which is expensive on AWS. We'll talk about that in a sec. I will skip one of the examples because we're low on time, but I will show you one more. One of the goals of this project build services where several things happened at the same time, and then the results were used together. So, for example, we have two threads kicked off here, A and B. One is computing one pipeline, the other is another, and then we're doing some of the results. And so what happens here is that we want them to run in parallel, entirely separately, in separate languages. And when the functions are done, we want the results to be synchronized, and then we want to do something with the results. In this case, it's a simple comparison. And the way to do this at the moment is to use some combination of multiple queues and connecting the outputs together and doing synchronization with harkets like clients, and instantly just go all computation and synchronization. I'm going to stop screen sharing because that's pretty much for it's a problem. So it is choppy. Okay, we're ending the talk. Right, let's scrap that. How's the audio now?
Better.
All right. We'll seem to stop. Okay. Yep. Okay, good. A little choppy.
You maybe want to just do a little bit of a, yeah, it's a little bit choppy.
Shall I do it again, do the cache?
Yeah. Yes.
Yes. Right.
Okay, you have presenter rights again.
Sweet. All right. This is interesting.
Okay, sound good though. Do you want to of what you that... discussed, like without going back to the code, just to
yes.
give a little bit of a summary. Overview?
Well, this is great because I was going to overview it anyway, so I will just do it and explain a little bit more while we look at the slides. So the first thing that we did was our basic pipeline in code, where we've got functions that have already defined. Can you see this like red dot? Is that a thing? That's it. I didn't realize.
Yeah, we can see it.
Great, I can see. This comment stream is distracting. It's all good. All good. So we've got a basic pipeline, and the cool thing is that it was very easy to put each of the Python functions a separate Lambda call and then pass the value between each Lambda call. So that's kind of useful, not extremely interesting, but kind of a first pass demo. Then how we can actually have multiple things happening at the same time. So not just passing data between Lambda functions, but actually having multiple Lambda functions being executed at the same time and then passing the results of those functions to other things down the stream. And I didn't show you, but if something did break, so for example, if one of these functions broke, say, I don't know, whatever, Python threw an exception, we would be able to get the entire context of that exception in the bigger context of the whole program. Then we didn't look at this at all, but we can do functional programming style things with Hark as well, where we, for example, we want to map over some values, a map in the sense of a for loop. We're going to add syntax to have proper for loops at some point, but for now you can actually just call map or those types of functional paradigms. So that's kind of useful. So now you can have a nice massive array and do a map reduce style computation, where each of the computation batches gets run on Lambda. And the interface for triggering these kinds of functions, there's a pretty generic interface. So one of the things, for example, that's implemented is an API endpoint that Hawk will set up for you automatically, and then you can curl or just browse to that API endpoint, and it will execute some Hawk code for you. There are a couple of other ways of executing functions, but fundamentally, if you can call an AWS Lambda function, you can call a Hawk function. So it's meant to be easy to integrate with other systems in your AWS account. And then a bunch of other things that are basically meant to make it easy and really, really fast to get up and running. I basically think there's a whole lot of boilerplate that I don't really want to have to deal with when I'm building my cloud stuff. So there are a few other parts of this talk that would be good to cover, but I'm going to focus on this one because we won't have time to do the others in detail. This question of why is this not embedded in Python, and why does this need to be a separate language? Because it's a question that I've been asking myself, and originally it was embedded in Python, but the semantics or the interface became awkward. Where there are a few things happening, and Py through main, we're waiting. So this is like Python 08. Able to serialized entire Python process. I actually want to completely shut down choppy again. Choppy. Still choppy. Oh, that's very interesting. Still choppy.
Does anyone have a good choppy pun to move? perhaps refresh.
Reach up. Right.
Okay, you're back.
So this must be my end. I think what could be causing it, bandwidth leak.
Well, we're all very much enjoying your talk, so don't be deterred. And also, we're going to open up a channel, I think, for your talk afterwards, so that people can chat to you outside of this. We'd love to be able to like hear you on a voice channel on Discord later as well.
So we'll definitely just
continue for now, and then we will.
Yeah,
I think we are running out of time. So if there's any questions,
maybe just wrap up
and then.
Yeah, I'll do a 30-second wrap up of the other topics that I was going to cover, and then people will have a better idea of what to ask or chat about in the Discord channel. So the topics that I was going to cover, this was only ever going to be very brief. Some of the implementation detail and some of the thoughts that went into how to make this work. There are a bunch of different aspects to this. It's part virtual machine implementation, part compiler implementation. I was going to review the other things and some of the limitations that we can talk about later. Let's hold it there because the questions are probably far more interesting.
All righty.
Better now. Oh, great. So you can hear me now.
Yeah. The general consensus is that it was an amazing talk outside of a little bit of technical difficulties. Everyone's quite keen to chat to you more about this topic. where can people find you on the internet? Obviously, you've got a Twitter handle. Is Twitter your preference?
Twitter's good. Twitter's good. Email's good. I think, well, actually, probably the canonical reference is just this. That kind of links to everywhere else on the internet. But yeah, Twitter, email.
Well, while we have you here, we've got, can Hark be used for other cloud platforms like Azure?
Yeah, so in principle, it can, the interface is super generic. I've only implemented it for AWS because you've got it somewhere. The interface is going to be extremely generic. It needs a key value store, object store, and cloud function. So yes, Azure, cloud, yeah.
Okay, cool. And do we have any other questions? Can you perhaps paste some links? So I think what we're going to do is we're going to open up a voice channel on Discord for you and your talk. And anyone who's got any other questions or want links to the code bases, someone was commenting that they tried to Google Hark and they found some weird economics model or something. A library for emulating economic models. So
yeah, about that.
Thanks to everybody for your patience, and I'm sorry for sending the wrong link. That was totally me. Face palming pretty hard right now, so I don't have my video on. Spare. Anyway, okay, with the questions, so data structures for Hark.
Yeah, so, at the shall I answer it, or should we change to Discord?
Yeah. Let's answer it quickly and then change.
Yeah, data structures. At the moment, I've implemented all of the JSON types. So string, was dictionaries. We've got big plans about typing and structured types.
I didn't quite catch you there. Can you repeat that?
Yeah. So we've implemented all of these types. So numbers, lists, and objects, dictionaries. We've got some vague plans for adding structured types inside the language.
Cool.
And it'll do the conversion between in Python and Hark as you can.
Okay, cool. I'm just chatting to Simon to open up a voice room in Discord. We're going to just name it serverless. So yep. Everyone that's in this room, if you've got any more questions, I'll also paste in these links that Rick's just shared into that. And just a few notes on the schedule side of things. One sec. So after this, we are going to be taking a bit of a long break, and you can join Rick and anyone else that's interested in the channel. And then after that, following, we have satellite data and super resolution to enhance slope soaring simulators by Skulkianus. And then modern JavaScript for Python developers by Corey Zhu. That is actually going to be in this room that we're in now. So yeah, the rooms are created, the serverless rooms. So if anyone wants to head there, yeah. All right, thanks so much.
Cheers.